Thank you, Sean. I'm really excited to be here and appreciate the opportunity to share my thoughts on high school cross country. Like most of you sitting here, my running career started with high school cross country. It was really my first love and where I first had success. I was the top underclassman as a junior in our state championships, and I grew up in Tennessee, and then finished fourth as a senior, though I learned an important lesson that I'll talk about in this talk as to why maybe I didn't win the state cross country championship. Then turned around and was able to win the 1600 meter title as a senior in high school. And that high school experience really started me on the career path that I have now, leading to, as Sean mentioned, a bachelor's degree in kinesiology, which is the study of anatomy and biomechanics, and then a master's in exercise physiology, how the systems of the body work to produce endurance performance. I've been very fortunate to carry that education into some mentorship with some of the greatest coaches in the world. On the far left there, Arthur Lydiard, got to tour with him on his last tour of the U.S. before he passed away. Most of you probably know Coach Vigil. I think all of us as coaches strive to be half the man that he is. I was able to serve for 2 years with Gabriella Rosa, who's an Italian coach and arguably the best marathon coach in the world, coach of Paul Tergat and several other amazing athletes. So also able to spend time with Dr. David Martin, who's written a book called Better Training for Distance Runners, which I highly recommend. And these experiences have been really important to me as I develop into hopefully a better and better coach. The successes were mentioned a little bit before, having athletes in the Olympic Games in Beijing in 2008, every World Track and Field Championship since 2001, Olympic Marathon Trials since 96, two U.S. National Championships in the last 9 months from athletes that train in our group in Flagstaff. Our men's team won the National Club Cross Country Championship 2 years ago. We put athletes on 14 U.S. teams over the last year and a half, and we just swept the U.S. 25K National Championships, taking first, second, and third. And I also coach Alvina Begay, who you know, and she's improved from 242 for the marathon down to 237. So we're applying a lot of these components that I'm going to talk about with the elite athletes, but all of that came from what I've learned from being a high school runner, getting the education I had, and then serving time with those coaches that I mentioned. What I thought I would do is talk about what I think are the key components to successful high school cross country. There are a few essential training principles that I think runners and coaches should apply. I've provided a sample training plan outline as to how, if I were to create a high school cross country plan, I would do it. Talk about some of the general conditioning workouts that you would perform, sort of what you do in the summer and early fall, and then some race-specific workouts that you would do as you entered your competitive season. And then talking to the coaches about how do you build your team culture and becoming that coach, that person who means so much to the young people and often changes their lives. So the first principle that we apply is that you must train at the level of your musculoskeletal system. Nobody strains a lung. Nobody pulls a vein. The cardiovascular system is very, very robust. We injure our muscles, tendons, ligaments, and bones. That's the number one limiting factor in training. The challenge we have is that normally when we are training, we judge our effort based on how we're feeling from a cardiovascular standpoint. You think about how hard am I breathing, and that's how you judge your effort level. The problem is that system is the wrong gauge to use because that system does not get injured. The musculoskeletal system gets injured. So we must make sure that the training is at a level that the musculoskeletal system can tolerate, not necessarily at the level that the cardiovascular system can tolerate. Does that make sense? We want to avoid injury, and the limiting factor is muscles, tendons, bones, and ligaments. So with patience and training at that musculoskeletal level, the body gets stronger and stronger and stronger. You can look at how much can a freshman tolerate versus a senior. Obviously, the senior can tolerate more training than the freshman can. That's because their musculoskeletal system has adapted to the training. So you really need to control training so that that musculoskeletal system can adapt, because the cardiovascular system can adapt faster and a greater rate than the musculoskeletal system. And by staving off injury, by avoiding injury, you allow the runner to progress from season to season and year to year. And I really believe the best thing that a coach can do for an athlete is to help avoid these injuries and interruptions in motivation and gaining fitness. So that's why training principle number one is train at the level of the musculoskeletal system, not necessarily your cardiovascular system. The second principle is to balance the stress-rest cycle. I think we all understand that when you run and you train, you stress the body. You fatigue the energy systems. You have to allow recovery for the body to grow stronger and be ready for the next training session. That's typically why we have a day or two between hard workouts, because we need to allow the body to adjust. So we must adhere to that stress-rest cycle. If that's ever out of balance, if we ever overstress and under-recover, that's a lead-in toward injury and fatigue. And I think in high school runners, because we're excited, we want to train hard, we want to be good, overtraining and under-recovery is a common error. I know I did that. I suffered through more injuries than I should have because I was excited and I overtrained and under-recovered. So for me, a lot of it is, how can you spread the stress across the training week? Think about every key workout as a stressful load, and how can you spread that across to allow enough recovery between the training systems? And as coaches, you'll realize quickly that each athlete has a slightly different stress-rest cycle. Some athletes can recover quicker from certain types of workouts and be ready to go for another hard workout sooner than others. And even each individual may have certain workouts they recover very quickly from, and other workouts take a little bit longer. I think we see in our elite training group that some workouts really fatigue certain athletes where it refreshes others. So it's very individual, and I think as you go through your season, you may have to vary where you input those stressful workouts based on your particular runners. Particularly if you have a star athlete, they may be able to handle more and more frequent stressful workouts, whereas your beginners may need less stressful and less frequent workouts to bring them along. It takes a lot more work for the coach to individualize that, but in the long run it pays off because your star runners are getting the proper amount of stimulus and you're bringing your beginners along at a rate that they're going to see success and stay in the sport. The third principle is that aerobic development is paramount to distance running success. And I think we all understand that every event, whether it's the 800 meters up to the marathon, is mostly aerobic. It has a high aerobic. Aerobic meaning that it's dependent on oxygen. It's dependent on your ability to take in oxygen and deliver it to the working muscles. The better you can deliver that oxygen, then the better you will perform. The aerobic system takes a long time to build to its peak. It takes years and years of training. So we have to think about having frequent and consistent exposure to aerobic running. And if you think about it, that's what your training mostly is. Most of the time, you're just going for a regular run, aren't you? You're not doing hard workouts every day. Most of your running is aerobic. It's at an easy pace. It's where you're able to breathe gently and hold a conversation. Physiologically, the benefits, and that's what's happening in your high school runners, the capillary beds, which are the small sort of veins or arteries in the muscles, they deliver the oxygen. You're increasing those, so you're putting more plumbing in around the working muscles. There are enzymes that help convert energy. You're building more of those. Mitochondria are within the muscle cell, and they actually are where the energy is produced. You get more of those, and they get larger. And that goes right along with the musculoskeletal development that we talked about. You're able to, as you run gently, you're gradually building the strength of the musculoskeletal system. And psychologically, all of us feel good when we put in good training. When you have a month of good, consistent training, you feel better, you feel more confident going into hard workouts and races. So what we try to do, or what I recommend, is that you build your performance ability simply through the aerobic system first. And then once you've sort of maximized that, you can supplement your aerobic system with race-specific training, particularly as your peak races improve. Because athletes can race fast off of aerobic training. It doesn't always take race-specific training. And if you can maximize your performance off of aerobic training, you know when you add your speed component, you will get fitter. So you try to year by year build your performance through that aerobic development. It's the greatest gift we can do is to start an athlete on a solid foundation of aerobic development through endurance training. General conditioning should come first, and then race-specific training should come second. And it's called the 75-25 rule, and I'll explain it. Peaking too soon is the number one error in high school cross-country teams. That's what happened to me and why I finished fourth instead of first, because I started, I peaked too soon. I peaked in the middle of the season. And I think everyone that's worked with high school runners knows that that's a common issue, that you perform very well prior to your most important races. And so what we have to do is figure out how to shift that so that you're peaking on time. What you want to be able to do is delay that peak until your championship season. And the best way to do that is to push the race-specific training only to the last 25 to 30% of your entire training cycle. And I'll show that in the outline that I have. What I've found is that I can achieve higher and more consistent peak performances by spending more time on general conditioning, workouts that prepare the athlete for fast training, than if I do race-specific training more frequently or earlier in the training cycle. That better general conditioning leads to better workouts when you do get into the race-specific training. And that 75-25 principle, that 75% of the training cycle is general conditioning, 25% is race-specific, takes a lot of patience. Obviously, if you start speed training earlier, you will get faster earlier. And we like that. We like to go into our early season races and sort of put a stamp on it and say, look at me, this is where I am. Look at our team, look where we are. But again, we want to avoid peaking too soon. And so we want to give your athletes the chance to be their best when it matters. The patience does pay off. I think the results that we're getting with our elite team show that we can peak on time. We can peak when we want to. But it does require a little bit of patience to do that. The fifth principle is that you must build your fitness gradually but progressively. And you need to plan for that success, don't just hope for it. It can be structured so that you can keep the training manageable for each athlete, but progress the volume and intensity from season to season to year to year. You can adjust the rate of the progression based on the athletic ability or durability of the athlete. So as you're working with athletes, you'll learn this athlete can tolerate more running or more frequent and higher intensity running than another athlete. But either case, you're still going to progress them gradually, but in a progressive manner. If you do this correctly, then the athletes will arrive in their senior year with a load of aerobic ability, great running form, and racing experience that will help them achieve their best results. And that's really what we're after, is to have that athlete finish your program in the best shape of their life and prepared for the next step. And this idea of gradual but progressive increases in training season by season and year by year can be planned. it can be written down as to how to do that. The sixth training principle is design your training plan for positive results to build and maintain motivation. What I've found is that the maintenance of motivation is the key to success. A fit and motivated athlete will always beat a fit and unmotivated athlete. And we know that. We've even experienced periods of time when we've been unmotivated in our own training. So what I try to do is set up the actual training so that the workout results will be positive. Because those positive workout results lead to increased motivation, increased interest in being better, increased motivation to do more positive workouts. And it starts this snowball where you have successful workout on top of successful workout. And suddenly, you've built this momentum that cannot be stopped. And that's what happens to lead athletes to peak performances. So for me, it's all about when I design the training plan, I want to make sure that the workouts that I'm giving the athletes should result in a positive experience for them. They should be successful in that workout to build motivation. Doesn't mean it's easy, but it just means that it should be successful. There's no reason to give them something they cannot accomplish because that will decrease motivation. I want them to be feel successful and feel very pumped up and motivated for the training that's upcoming. The seventh principle is that you have to create your team's culture and your own coaching and training philosophy. You and your team leaders must create and cultivate your spirit of the team. We talked a lot about this when we were setting up our training group in Flagstaff. We felt it was very important what would be the spirit of our group. What would be the culture in our team? What do we want that to be like, and how can we establish that? We really wanted to establish that culture of success, culture of excellence. And if we did that, we knew the results would come. They always do. Young people are starving for something to buy into. If you're like me, I was bored in high school. You go to school, you sit through class, there's not a lot of excitement. You want something to buy into. You want something to be a part of. So your team and the leadership can be that switch flipper. It can flip that switch and get somebody motivated to be better than they ever thought they could be, to change their lifestyle and their behavior, to go beyond what they ever thought they could be. It did it for most of us. That's why we're still in the sport. So we want to create an environment where they're in it not just for themselves, but for something bigger. It's not just about yourself, but there's also the team component. There's school pride, and there's fun in working hard together toward a common goal. Joe Vigil talks a lot about creating your coaching and training philosophy, that you have to have a way that you are going to coach and a way that you are going to train. That's your philosophy. You're open to adjusting that as you learn and grow, but you have a philosophy at the start. Our goal is to inspire the athletes to go beyond themselves, to live through their tough times and always believe in themselves. That's the role of the coach. The eighth principle is that we must individualize training as our peak season nears. And this we certainly have to do with the elite group, is that can really lead them to their peak performances, their best of their best races. And a lot of times in high school, we think about individualization simply by fitness level. So we have an A group, a B group, and a C group. So you have your A athletes who are the fittest, your B athletes not quite there yet, C athletes oftentimes beginning runners that need to build their fitness. But you can also segment your training and individualize it by the type of runner that you're working with. We're all different runners, aren't we? Some of us are endurance monsters. The longer, the better. That's the great thing. Some of us are speedsters. Get us on the track, and we do fantastic. Some of us are kind of versatile. We can do a little bit of everything. So you can individualize the training based on that. For the speedster, give them more speed as the peak race nears, because they like that. They thrive on it. For the endurance monster, give them more endurance type training. Individualize your training based on the type of runner that you're working with as well. And that's, we're talking the last 3 or 4 weeks, being able to individualize it. If you cater the workouts in the race-specific phase to each type of athlete, you can lead them into the peak races with a full head of steam, with a lot of motivation and feeling like they are prepared for that peak performance. And the last training principle is that we must build self-confidence through the belief in the athlete. Animals respond best to positive reinforcement. They've done studies with rats where there's one study where they're on a treadmill and they run to exhaustion and they'll have food or some positive reinforcement if they stay on the treadmill longer. And then they have another one that's negative, so maybe they get shocked if they go toward the back. They will always run longer with the positive reinforcement. Always. So with consistent and appropriate positive reinforcement, the athlete's self-confidence will skyrocket. And you can talk to athletes in our elite training group, and you know, we have a very positive environment. There's a lot of positive vibes going on. Each athlete does require a slightly different method of building self-confidence, and that's what you learn in working with the athlete. But if you continually show them that you believe in them, that they are doing great, then no matter how it's achieved, whether training results, workout results, you simply having a nice conversation with them, it's the most important factor in running success is an athlete's self-confidence going into training.